Vahini Mekyonimana, ladies and gentlemen, no flashbulbs, please. Our performers are temperamental and easily upset. Thank you for your cooperation.
Oh, look at all the people.
My goodness, you're all staring at us. We better start the show rolling.
Wait, wait. We forgot to wake up the Glee Club.
Tahuwa'ila, tahuwa'ila, eguhenila, pili'ko'olu'ala,
ututu. Hey, howdy, hey. And thank you for joining us here on China Tiki Talk. We are your hosts. I'm Sean.
I'm Alan.
I'm Keith.
So grab yourself a Dole Whip, pull up a chair, and enjoy the show. This is episode 48 for the week of September 21st, 2014. I'm really excited to speak with the frontman of the band who is closing out the Eat to the Beat concert series from November 8th through the 10th. Please welcome Scotty from the Big Bad Voodoo Daddy into the Tiki Hut.
Now I'm the king of the swingers balls, jungle VIP. Well, I reached the top and had to stop, and that's what's bothering me. I want to be a man of my club, stroll right into town, and be just like the other men. I'm tired of monkeying around.
How did Big Bad Voodoo Daddy get started?
Well, basically got started just like any other band, really. It just, I had an idea of what I wanted to do as a musician. I'd been working in Los Angeles. I'm from Southern California, and was working in the studios and touring with bands and making records with other people, and decided just to do my own thing. And the guys that I started the band with in that very early stage, they were all still the same guys that are in the band now. I got really lucky with when I was meeting guys at that particular time looking to do something different. It was just meant to be honest with you.
It was like the perfect point in, music history, and that, you know, that day and age, and you guys got a big jump from the movie Swingers, and that's where I became a fan of yours. You know, that,
right.
I'm an East Coast person, so I'm not in the LA scene, music scene, so I didn't hear about you guys. So seeing Swingers, I remember going to seeing you guys in New York City just months after Swingers came out, and that was just, you guys had an incredible response from that film. What was that like, getting that boost from Swingers?
It was pretty incredible. I mean, we had been together for about 5 years before Swingers had come out, and we were just about to work on our third record, and we're playing our residency at the Derby. And basically, what you see that went on that night was shot live that night at the Derby. That was just a typical Wednesday night. At the time, Favreau wasn't making movies, and he wasn't a big star yet. So at that point, he and I were very good friends. He just handed me one night a script, and bam, the rest is history. And for us, it was amazing because we had this really small underground following because, we had two records out at that point, and all we were doing is jumping in a van and, you know, playing from Wednesday to Monday anywhere we could. We'd go up the coast, down the coast, we'd go into Texas, we'd gone all over the place. And then when Swingers hit, it went from, 300, 400 people showing up a night to, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000. It just kept going crazy.
I fell in love with that film. So I was the perfect age when that film came out. And I've always enjoyed, swing music and jazz music, blues. I was a big Sinatra fan. So your music always hit home to me. And I always appreciated the music that you guys have put out and how your albums have changed over the years. It's been a great run to listen to you guys as a fan.
I appreciate that, man. That's really what we're doing. I mean, we're not trying to make the same record. We're not trying to do the same thing. And really, hindsight is 50-50, because if you think about it, Big Bad Voodoo Daddy officially started playing together in 1991. And the number one song on the radio in 1991 was Smells Like Teen Spirit. To try
That's
to convince
right.
guys to play swing music when grunge and heavy, like alternative music, was the thing, there just was no scene. I kind of feel like, because I came from the punk rock world, I kind of feel like that attitude was, I thought that would be the most punk rock thing you could do, is do a swing band in the middle of all this grunge and all this alternative stuff. And to be honest with you, it was crazy, because it was the music that I was hearing in my head anyway. You don't just all of a sudden one day decide, hey, man, I'm going to write swing music. There's some pretty big shoes to fill. Really big shoes to fill.
The great thing about it is that you come from the punk rock, music, and you get a taste of that a lot of times when you close your shows from using Nirvana's Smells Like Teen Spirit to close a show, and the audience always goes nuts.
Yeah, we do. There's a bunch of stuff that we do in there, and all of it is really sort of subliminal, you know? It's like,
right.
Sometimes we do Sweet Home Alabama. It just depends on it. But there's kind of like a hidden tongue-in-cheek thing in there big time because, like I said, Smells Like Teen Spirit was the number one song. So we used to close with that back in the day because it would just be such a off thing to do at the end. And then when I was a little kid, and I used to play in like high school bands when I was 12 and 13 years old, and those guys, all they ever wanted to play was Lynyrd Skynyrd, where I'm from. You know, everyone's playing Sweet Home Alabama. Just like, and I swear to God, I used to say, God, if I have to play Sweet Home Alabama one more time, I'm going to quit music for good. We close with that song too, and it's almost the exact opposite, I think, of what most people think it is.
Right. In the 20 plus years that you guys have been performing and recording, how do you guys feel you've changed or grown the most in that time?
I think we're getting more focused on what it is we do. I mean, I think that's because over time, I think what it's allowed us to do is sort of look at a broad scope of work, and we kind of have been able to get focused. It's like, okay, I know what we are and I know what we aren't. And so when I'm writing music or bringing music in, I'm constantly trying to challenge that amongst the band members. And anytime I write anything or anytime I bring something into the band, you know, I have to run it by six other guys, you know, and I have to make sure that those guys are going to want to play that every night. And I don't want them to get up and just play it. I want them to play it, you know? And so I think it's really one of those deals where I think we're just maybe getting better at knowing what we do and how to challenge each other. So it's good every single night, because that's the one thing that we've always tried to do first and foremost is keep our live show at the highest quality possible.
Right. Yeah, because your music is extremely infectious, and it's just plain old feel-good music. And, you know, that's the one thing I love about your live music, your record. I mean, granted, your records, you know, your studio records are really good, but once you see you guys live, it's a whole different ballgame. Can you tell our listeners what people would expect to hear from you when you're performing live?
You know, it's really wide open, and it's really the intention of our live show is to completely take you out of your space and transport you into another space completely. And that space is usually really a good vibe, because the music is really up. We try and keep the music up as much as possible. And really it's a musical history as well, because in being together for so many years, 21 years now, with all the original guys, and it's like there's a music history that's gone in with this. And so I try to do everything from music from the late 1920s all the way up to, you know, what was the last era of big band, which would have been probably like the 60s. So we try to encompass that in everything we do, as well as, I mean, it's a clean show where there's no gimmick. It's just nine guys on stage playing their hearts out, and it's fun. And because we've been together for so long, that there's something that happens within the feel of the music, the groove, that you can't really teach, because it took us so many years to learn to play with each other, and it took us so many years of playing the same songs over and over and over every night, that something happened that with a band that's that big, that's been together that long, that plays as many times a year as we do, that it's undescribable. And I think you hit it right on the head. It's our records don't come close to what the live show is, and that's what we've always been. Is we've always been a live band, and we make records because you have to make records, and that's how people hear you and promote by. But to be honest with you, our live show is really our bread and butter of what we do.
Yeah, like America got a taste of it during Super Bowl 33. So, you know, your audience just jumped open, you know, tens of millions of people. I mean, what was that experience like?
It was amazing, you know, because, you know, it's crazy, because you think about who plays the Super Bowl. Like, you people that have number one hits play the Super Bowl. Like, that's who plays the Super Bowl, you know? The Rolling Stones played the Super Bowl. We played with Stevie Wonder and Gloria Estefan. And at that time, Gloria Estefan was one of the biggest female artists on the planet. With her Latin audience was so huge, and then her American audience is so huge. And then Stevie Wonder is, you know, I mean, he's royalty. So we were just dumbfounded, because we never even had a radio hit. Like, we never had Go Daddy O, You Need the Ball Next Three. All the songs that were singles, those songs were never, like, number one hits. So we were just like, wow, man, if they're going to allow us to play in front of this many people, bring it on. We'll just go for it and see what happens.
Yeah, that was incredible. As a fan, that was, you know, that was great to see. So it was so much fun.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing. I got to be honest with you. It was totally amazing. And you know, you just, it's a hard one to, it's a hard one to figure out yourself, really, to be honest with you.
Is there one album that would basically tell us your band's story, represents you the best that you guys produced?
I don't know. That's a good point. I don't know if there is, you know. I mean, I always hope that our last records are our best records and the ones. And I always think of every record, because we've tried to make every record so completely different. I see every record as sort of a new chapter,
right,
of a different direction that we're trying to take. You know, when Americana Deluxe came out, which was the record that had all the songs that it would go Daddy O that'll also play the Super Bowl, that record was what we were playing at the Derby and the small clubs, and that's the best we had gotten up to that point. That was where we were. And then the album after that was basically just a reaction to all that success, you know, because no one prepares you for that, trust me. And
right.
Then after that, you know, every record we did was sort of a reaction to the last record, or to whatever was going on in our lives at the time, because we were doing close to 250 shows a year at that point. We were just,
wow,
we were just nonstop. All we were doing was playing. And, you know, I had just got it in my head that, like, guys like B.B. King and whatnot, that's how the old school cats did it, man. They just went out and they solidified their live thing, you know? And so that's what we did. We just bit down hard and went for it. And thankfully it worked, because we're still here, and we have a really committed fan base that still wants to come out and hear us play music.
Oh, yeah. So you guys have done a lot with Disney over the years, from the Christmas Day Parade to having a song on the Wild soundtrack, and now to the Epcot E to the B concert series. How did your relationship with Disney start?
It originally started with Swinger soundtrack. The Swinger soundtrack was on Hollywood Records. When Hollywood Records put the record out, they weren't doing any self-promotion for it, because they didn't know the movie was going to be a hit. So we started doing all these in stores, because the movie blew us up, and we wanted to try to, you know, get as much promotion out of it as we could. So we started doing in stores when record stores were still around and whatnot. And we would do all these things, and we were promoting this record, and the record caught on fire. And then somebody from the Disney office found out that we were doing that, and they were really very pleased that we were supporting this record and really going out and doing something about it. That we sort of connected a relationship at that point. And then from that point on, I'd say we usually do something pretty substantial with Disney. Every couple of years, we're doing something pretty interesting and pretty fun, which is great. I love it, because Disney is a great company to be working with.
Yeah, because you also, I know you're a big sports fan. I know that you were the house band for the ESPYs a few times, I think, correct, right?
That is correct. Yeah, we did it 2 years.
That must have been a great experience, because you were, you know, in front of all these sports stars and celebrities, and I mean, that's just got to be, you know, that's got to be a different experience compared to the Super Bowl.
It was a totally different experience, and to be honest with you, it was so mind-blowing. It was probably the most mind-blowing thing that we've done. We have done so many unbelievable things, and this one, I don't know, this one was probably one of the top most intimidating things that we've ever done, because here we are. We're at Radio City Music Hall. We're playing on stage live, and we did it. I mean, we did everything. I mean, I was calling cues. There was no music. We just went for it. I just knew what we were going to do, and we just kind of went. I call it flying without a net, and we just went for it. And sitting in the front row was every single number one athlete on the planet, from every sport you could think of, sitting there staring right at you, front row, man. That was so completely intimidating. It was unbelievable.
Oh, I bet. I mean, I just couldn't imagine it. I mean, here's these guys who've won Super Bowls and NBA championships and you know, the World Series, and here you are, you know, playing right in front of them. It's gotta be crazy.
It was amazing. It was awesome. And it was like, you know, that's when you really realize, you know, what you're made out of, because trust me, you know, you're like I said, you're flying without a net, man. You're just going for it.
Right. And now you guys also performed on the Disney Christmas Day Parade.
Yeah.
You filmed that a few weeks beforehand, but did you happen to watch it Christmas morning?
I did, yeah, the whole family. I never watch what we do on TV. Like, I've never even seen a Super Bowl performance. I've seen Swingers once, and that was at the movie premiere when they were trying to sell it. I just never watch our stuff. It always, like, messes it up for me, so I kind of like remembering the moment as it was, you know?
Right.
And, but this one, my kids were like, no, Dad, we gotta watch it, so... My whole family, they recorded it on the DVR, and then And then when we all got together, my whole family, everybody got together, and we watched it. And my kids were really young at that time, too. So Phineas and Ferb, the song was for Phineas and Ferb. So
right.
Phineas and Ferb, my kids are more impressed that I knew Phineas and Ferb than pretty much anything else I've done in my career.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's amazing how things like that happen. Like, you could perform for the president, but... You know, just because you did something with Disney, with Phineas and Ferb, you know, they love you more for that. It's amazing.
It's 100% true. We've played for three presidents. I've met our last three presidents. And it's classic that my kids have never even asked me, like, what was that like? Or, in one of the back rooms, I have some pictures of us with the president and whatnot. And my kids have never even asked me a question. But trust me, Phineas and Ferb was, I got interrogated.
That's crazy. So what is it like performing in Epcot for the E to the Beat concert series as opposed to performing at other venues?
I love the Epcot. I got to be honest with you. I think that I look forward to that every year we do it. It is such an incredible event. When we first were doing it, you know, we'd always been either on the road a lot, so I never really got to enjoy it. But now I make sure that I go. I go every single day. I go try all the food. I walk around and I have a really, really good time. And it's really, really fun. It's a great event because there's a lot of fans come to this. I mean, I get people all year long saying, see you in Epcot, see you in Epcot, see you in Epcot. I mean, all year long. So really what it is it's a really good chance to, because I know what kind of experience they're having during the day because it's, you know, Epcot is really fun, especially for this event. And then they get there and they're listening to us and we play three times a day. And it's just, it's really a really fun event. So there's a lot of people that repeat, people that come every year. And then it's cool, too, because then there's a whole boatload of people who have never even heard of us before. And they get a chance to see us play on, a number one stage. That stage is such a great stage. They do such a good job with the way they make that stage up and the way that they run that thing. It's just, I'm impressed every year that the event is just run so well. So for me, it's one of the highlights, to be honest with you.
Yeah, this is actually I've wanted to go see you guys down there perform so many times over the years, and this is actually the first time I'm going to be down there. It's the first time I'm going to be down there for Food and Wine, but it's also going to be the first time I'm actually going to see you guys perform. So I'm really looking forward to that as a big fan. So that's going to be a great show.
Oh, cool. Yeah, you're going to dig it, man. It is a great event, man. It's really fun.
So do you have a favorite thing that you've done for the Walt Disney Company? Would it be the ESPYs?
The ESPYs was probably one of the most memorable things. I'm trying to think. We've done some. I had a really good time, to be honest with you, on that Christmas show that we did.
Right.
When we did the Christmas show, that was really fun, man. That was just like a really fun day because we brought all of us brought our families down to Disneyland, and it was a beautiful day. The shoot went really smooth. I love that song. It's such a fun song. And I got to see the guys from Phineas and Ferb, and it was nice hanging out with them. And they were those guys were such great guys, too. It was just really, that was a really, really fun day. My kids got to see me play and do something kind of fun and special. And I don't know, man, it was really awesome. I think that was a really fun one, too, for Disney.
Yeah, well, your Christmas shows really make you guys stand out. I mean, I know you guys sell out those, and people look forward to those all year long because it's not something that you're going to get in the middle of the summer. So, you know, your Christmas music, I mean, you've had two Christmas albums. Your most recent one was, what, I believe, last year or so. And, you know, they're always popular. I love them. I've taken people to see the Christmas shows, and they're instant fans just from the Christmas shows.
Oh, cool. Thanks, man. Yeah, but the Christmas music is really, I mean, I just wanted to try and do something different with a Christmas show. Because, I mean, when you go to a Christmas show, usually Christmas shows, when I was a kid, I remember it was just always the same songs. It was always the same thing. And I thought, man, if we could just do something interesting and put a spin and maybe write a few original songs and have there be some kind of fun and humor in there. You know, I just think that people would really enjoy that because people love their Christmas music. I mean, good God, they really do. So it's been really fun trying to do that. Our first Christmas record was primarily based on trying to write original music and then taking songs that no one had ever heard that were Christmas songs and try to do something fun and witty with them. And then on our second Christmas record, because we had already done something kind of quirky, our second record was this last one, It Feels Like Christmas Time, was really based on how much can we challenge ourselves and do something really different and really classy with this great genre of Christmas music by taking all the classics that we thought would fit well in the Big Bad Voodoo Daddy umbrella and do something interesting and fun with them. And I'm really proud of that record. I think it was a really fun record to make, and it was interesting because you know, you have to make a Christmas record in the summertime.
Right.
And so trying to do Christmas music in July in Southern California was really interesting.
Yeah, it's, you know, Christmas music, and you stand out. It's not like you're not just putting out another cover that, you know, 300 artists have done before you. I mean, your music stands out. It's completely different. It's not like everybody else's. So, you know, that's what I love about
it. Yeah, that's, thank you, man. I mean, I'm not kidding you. We worked so hard. We worked so hard so that we wouldn't do anything that was in any tradition of anybody else that anyone had ever done before. And, you know, like I said, I feel really proud of that record also. So, thank you.
So what's next for Big Bad Voodoo Daddy?
We're coming off of a five-year run where we made 3 records in 5 years, and we toured incessantly the entire time. So right now, this year, 2014 was a slowed down year. We all decided to take a step back and probably play half as many shows as we've done in the past. So for us, we're probably doing about 100 shows this year.
Okay.
And which is still a lot, but it's we're just kind of slowing down. And then really what it's going to be is, you know, what's the next direction? Because if you just work and you burn out, it's like, you know, I don't know what my motivation will be for it. So right now I'm really on chill zone and just trying to think about anything. And I know that a new record and a new show is on the works for 2015. But as far as 14 is concerned, we're just going to be laying low. I'm writing music right now, but I'm not pushing it. I'm just kind of seeing what happens.
So the last 5 questions I have are real quick. If you can answer them, that's great.
Sure.
This is the Tiki Lightning Round. This is all basically Disney parks related. Do you have a favorite snack that you've had in the parks?
A favorite snack? Well, French fries are my favorite snack, so I'm going to say French fries.
All right. You have a favorite attraction?
And I like the French fries actually in the animal park, to be specific.
Oh, okay. Okay. A favorite attraction?
I like Kilimanjaro.
That's a great. Your favorite character?
My favorite character, Minnie Mouse.
Your favorite Disney movie?
My favorite Disney movie is Jungle Book.
You had a song from there, which is a great song.
Yep.
And your favorite Disney park memory?
Does Pixar count for Disney?
Yes. Yep.
Oh, Toy Story then. All 3.
That's a great one. Yeah, you got
to
count those as
I
one.
I have to say for it.
Yep.
Yeah, I count them all as one. So Toy Story and Jungle Book, they're like tied.
Perfect.
Favorite memory is by far the first time I went to Disney when I was a little kid and doing the actual Jungle Book ride. Oh, no, sorry, Pirates of the Caribbean. Terrified. I was probably like 5 or 4 in L.A. at the Anaheim one, and we did it, and I'll never forget it. I was terrified until we got into the big room when they were firing the pirate ships.
And I'm sure now you'll love it.
Then I was good to go.
Yeah.
I loved it. Right when we hit that point, I was like, oh, I love this.
Right.
And from that point on, I always torture the guys. Like, oh, no, we got to go on Pirates, man. I don't care. Let's just go.
Got to let the kid out in you once in a while.
Heck yeah. I always let it out. That's my problem.
All right, Scotty, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it. And, you know,
my
I look
pleasure,
forward
man.
To seeing your show in November.
Cool. Thanks a lot, man.
To find more about Big Bad Voodoo Daddy, please check out their website, bbvd.com, and you can see tour information, music videos, and discography. And you can also check them out on Twitter at bbvd.
That's going to do it for this week's show. Be sure to let us know what you thought. You can comment in the notes over at enchantedtikitalk.com. You can email us at podcast@enchantedtikitalk.com, and you can leave us a message on the Tiki Talk hotline, which is 256-4MY-TIKI. That's 256-469-8454. Be sure to like us on Facebook, check out our store at redbubble.com, and follow us on Twitter at Tiki Talk Podcast. Lastly, if you enjoy the show, please take the time to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes.
And you can find me at 1 Minute Disney Dream, that's 1 MIN Disney Dream, on Twitter and mouseworldvacations.com.
And you can find me on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Dole Whip Daily, and online at dolewhipdaily.com.
And you can follow me on Twitter and on Instagram. I'm at Norman Bates, that's NORMNB, the number 8 and the letter S. Thanks for listening this week. For Sean and Keith and our special guest, Scotty from Big Bad Voodoo Daddy, I'm Alan, and this has been Enchanted Tiki Talk. Aloha. I like to see your smiling face.